Thank you for joining us. Congressman Ted Deutch is described as a young rising voice in the House Democratic Caucus and one of America's top Jewish politicians. He's a member of the House Judiciary Committee, the House Ethics Committee, and the House Foreign Affairs Committee, in which he serves as the ranking member on the Middle East and North Africa Subcommittee. Congressman Deutch is dedicated to many essential causes and has an excellent perspective on what the priorities should be at this time in history, and he'll share his views on these subjects following these messages. With us now is Congressman Ted Deutch. It's a pleasure to have you back on the show.
Great to be with you. Thank you.
So many things have happened since the last time we were conversing on television, and constant changes in world events and so forth. But right here in the United States, you are very much involved with the economy and finding jobs. Tell us a little bit about progress in that direction.
Well, we've seen a lot of progress. The economy has continued to get better, but there's so much more that we can do. There are a lot of steps that we can take to improve the economy. One that I spend a lot of time working on is, and that has broad bipartisan support, is trying to bring together the government and the private sector to invest in infrastructure so that we can have the best bridges, the best roads, the best airports, seaports that will help us compete. First of all, make things more convenient for people in this country, and it will help us compete with other countries around the world.
With various controversies that also exist continuously and concerns about bridges aging and streets and infrastructure aging, brings to mind in old Rome, the bridges in Rome 2,000 years old are still being used by buses and trucks. It's rather amazing. So maybe we need to revisit our designs, God knows. Anyway, back to reality. So there's so many challenges socially and other, in this case, tax. The Treasury Inspector General for the Tax Administration said in September of last year that potentially fraudulent tax returns are issued, totaling about $3.6 billion in 2011 alone. What can Congress do this tax season to require that the IRS fix these problems of billions of dollars in losses?
You're right to point out that this is an issue that is growing in large part because of criminals who are operating internationally. Just recently, my 90-year-old mother got a phone call from someone who claimed to be her grandson, and if she could just provide some money to him, then she would be helping him, and he was going to be okay. These are the kinds of scams that are committed on a daily basis, and I've introduced legislation to target that specific issue of senior fraud. The fact is that seniors in our country are preyed upon more than anyone, and if we can create a specific place that seniors can turn in government for assistance that can help educate them, that can prevent this sort of thing from happening, we'll be taking a huge step to cut down on the amount of fraud. At the same time, identity theft is a big issue, and there are efforts underway in Congress to try to combat identity theft, make it harder to steal someone's identity, make it easier for people who are victims to take action so that their credit rating isn't affected and so that they're able to get on with their lives.
I would imagine that many of your constituents are victims of this kind of fraud, and you'd be even more admired, I guess, if you're able to get your colleagues in Congress to move forward. In fact, what about the idea of your proposing such legislation to move forward?
Sure. Well, our efforts, I mean, to date, we've moved forward in a bipartisan way. There are a number of members of Congress from Florida in particular, Democrats and Republicans, who have worked to strengthen the laws so that people who commit identity theft will face harsher penalties, and in order to help people prevent their identity from being stolen in the first place. We get a lot of phone calls in our office from people who have been victimized, and we have to help them turn to all of the different places in government where their identity might be, the fact that their identity has been stolen might impact them. it should be easier to do. And one of the things we're trying to do is give them that access so that if they're a victim, they can take action that will help them and will stop the thief from being able to use the information.
I'd like to change topics and move offshore and ask you about that troubled part of the world, the Middle East, where Israel continues to be surrounded by a very hostile environment and, of course, continuously hoping for peace. What are your thoughts with regard to the ever-changing Middle East in general?
The point that you make is the right one. Israel finds itself in a part of the region, in a part of the world where it is surrounded by countries who, for the most part, it counts as enemies. And we need to work to, number one, to ensure that Israel is able to defend herself. Number two, we have to work to address the problems that surround Israel. In the peace that Israel enjoys with Egypt and Jordan, we have to work to sustain. In Egypt, their move toward democracy is one that we ought to support. In Jordan, because of the crisis in Syria, Jordan faces a huge refugee problem, and we, I think, have to work hard, the United States has to work hard with our allies to ensure that those refugees get the humanitarian assistance that they need so that they don't pose a risk to the Jordanian government. For friends of Israel like us, it's really important that Jordan be able to continue to thrive and uphold its end of the peace agreement with Israel. These are the sorts of things that I think we have to be concerned with.
It's such a shame because in cooperation and peace as such exists somewhat with Egypt and Jordan, if there was more cooperation, the entire problems there could be resolved. But if others would recognize Israel's right to exist, and if in a spirit of cooperation, problems would be resolved and coexistence would occur.
Excuse me, I had an interesting meeting with Foreign Minister Lieberman from Israel recently. And I think his approach and his sense of what's happening in the region is accurate when he describes the situation on the ground where some of the countries who have historically been Israel's enemies now look at the region and realize that for them, and in particular the Gulf states, for them, the threats posed by an Iran that's trying to acquire nuclear weapons, the threats that are posed by Hezbollah, by Al-Qaeda, those are the real threats that they should be worrying about. Israel's not a threat to them. And for some of the more moderate states, it makes much more sense for them to work with Israel to combat these other threats and to help grow the economy, Israel being an economic miracle in that region, than it does to try to focus everyone's attention in a negative way on Israel. We haven't seen that yet, but I think he's right. In the meetings that I've had, I think there is a greater willingness on the part of some of those countries to move in that direction. That could really change the nature of the dynamics in the region.
Again, to change topics, of course, I agree with you. We all hope for peace and intelligent resolutions in the Middle East and, of course, everywhere in the world. Yep. But back here in the United States, what are your thoughts on healthcare? What's happening?
Well, there's not a domestic issue that's been as widely debated over the past few years than healthcare. And I think what we have to keep in mind is that the goal, and this is a goal that everyone shares, is that we have a healthcare system that provides the best healthcare that does so without bankrupting our country. And it gives people the choices that they need and the access to affordable coverage. Over the past couple of years, you've seen steps taken through the Affordable Care Act to make sure that access is available to people so that if they have pre-existing conditions, they're still able to get insurance. If they've had insurance and they get sick, to ensure that the insurance company can't cancel their policy just because they get sick. And most importantly, for people who have never had access to healthcare before, who went to the emergency room when they got sick, which all of us wound up paying for, to give them choices to be able to get basic coverage that's going to provide the coverage they need so they can get treatment and avoid having to go to the emergency room. That's going to bring down costs. those are all the things that have to happen. Those are that's the direction we're going, but we have to keep moving forward. We can't afford to get mired in debates about things that are already the law that are having positive effects. We need to work together to change those things that may need changing, and to build upon the areas that are already successful.
Absolutely. Another area that you're very active in is that of civil rights. And I would like to remind our audience that it was Jewish people back at the last century in the 50s and 60s who were very, very active. In fact, some people say founded the civil rights movement, were marching in Alabama, Mississippi, even lynched alongside black African Americans. Mm-hmm. Give us an update on civil rights.
The kinds of struggles that the civil rights movement faces today are different. I serve with John Lewis. John Lewis was a great civil rights pioneer, and he's told me stories about what it was like in those early days of the civil rights movement when he was advocating for voting rights, and he would take a group of African Americans with him to a polling place, only to arrive at the polling place, have the poll worker lift up a big jar of jelly beans, place that jar of jelly beans on the table in front of the voters, and ask them to tell them how many jelly beans are in the container, which obviously no one can do. And when they got it wrong, they said, "I'm sorry, you're not able to vote today." He said, those we talk about poll taxes, those are the sorts of things that were done that made it harder for people to vote, that disenfranchised a lot of people early in the civil rights movement. Today it's different. Today there are actions being taken to make it harder for people to vote by limiting the number of hours they can vote, by requiring more forms of identification when they vote, by trying to disenfranchise people by kicking them off of the voting rolls, even though they're eligible voters. Those are the sorts of things that I think we need to combat. We ought to be working hard, and the community, our community in particular, having been on the receiving end, and unfortunately still being on the receiving end so often of acts of hatred, we ought to be working to ensure that everyone has greater access to vote, because when more people participate in our system, they're more invested in it, and we have a government that works better for them.
Absolutely, sir. Of course, there's also the question of voter fraud. And what intelligent solutions would you consider in that regard?
Well, it's interesting. There, in my state, in Florida, there was a very widely reported effort to try to address the issue of voter fraud by conducting a purge of the voter rolls meant to throw off people who aren't eligible to vote. In fact, what we learned was that, number one, there was no great problem of voter fraud. It doesn't exist. But more than that, the result of this effort was to target people like a gentleman from South Florida that we identified who was a World War II veteran, who received a notice telling him that he's no longer eligible to vote. Small business owners who received the same notices. In the name of voter fraud and fighting voter fraud, there was an effort that would have resulted in thousands and thousands of eligible voters losing the right to vote. Again, we should work, and the supervisors of elections and election officials all across the country work every day to make sure that the voter rolls are up to date. They should do that, and we should give them the tools to do it. But we shouldn't use the issue of voter fraud where it doesn't exist to make it harder for people who, in some cases, even fought for our country to exercise their constitutional rights.
Another issue of concern is that of finding employment for returning Army veterans and those who've also lost their jobs because of the changing space industry. Please share with our viewers your thoughts on finding employment for such individuals.
Well, I've worked hard, the people in my office and I have all worked hard to try to impress upon our local employers why it's important for them to hire returning soldiers, why it's important for them to hire veterans. We've had meetings with local colleges. We've conducted jobs fairs. Some I've conducted with my colleagues, other colleagues of mine in the House, throughout South Florida, bringing together these employers and giving them the opportunity to meet with veterans. A lot of companies now realize that what veterans offer to them is something that they have a hard time finding in other employees, the ability to make decisions under pressure, the ability to lead, the ability to interact with others. those are the types of skills that they bring. We just work hard to put together the give opportunities for the veterans to meet with employers and to meet with educational institutions so that they know what educational opportunities are available, all to try to give them what they deserve, having risked their lives for our country. I think we owe it to them, owe them the opportunity of finding good positions, educating themselves, and ultimately becoming really productive members of our economy and our society.
This is all very interesting. I'd like us to continue, but we have to pause for these commercial messages. We'll be right back. We're back with Congressman Deutch. Sir, I'd like to continue and ask you a little bit about your background. When did you decide to run for office?
Well, I've always been involved in the community. I was involved in the pro-Israel community from the time I was a high school student. I was involved in lots of organizations all throughout college. And then when I started practicing law, I got involved in politics as well, trying to help people that I thought were people who shared my values, trying to help them get elected. And I was really involved in my local organizations, the local pro-Israel community, and some national groups as well. I didn't think that I would run for office, but when a state Senate position opened in 2005, I decided that if I had the opportunity to try to do something that might help even more people than I was able to help in my private life, that it was worth pursuing. And I ran for state Senate. I thought that I would do that for a while and then go back to my law practice. Funny thing happened to my plans. My congressman decided to leave to run an organization dedicated to Middle East peace, and that was unexpected and created an opening that I didn't expect I would see. And I jumped in and have been in Congress ever since, working on all the same issues that I worked on before, trying to help ensure the strongest U.S.-Israel relationship, working to make sure that families have an opportunity to succeed, that kids can get a good education, and that seniors can live out their lives in dignity. These are the same sorts of issues that I've been involved in all my life. Now I just get to do it as a member of Congress.
You are considered as a rising star in Congress and among the top Jewish politicians in the history of the country, and well, I'm proud to be sitting here with
you.
If I may ask, what are your plans for the future?
I love the job that I have now. I'm the ranking member on the Middle East Subcommittee. I work every day on the issues that I care so deeply about. And along the way in this job, you look for any opportunity that, in my case, it would give me the chance to do more for even more people. And that might be in other positions in the House, or who knows, at some point in the future, there might be some other office that would give me those opportunities too. But I'm really focused on the work that I get to do now, that I'm privileged to do every day for the people of the 21st District.
Before we conclude, sir, would you present a final message to our audience?
Yeah, my message to the audience is thank you. Thank you. I don't even know which way to look. There aren't enough people in the country who spend the time that your viewers spend trying to understand the issues, trying to figure out how they can become more knowledgeable and better advocates for the things they believe in, whether it's support for the state of Israel or any of the other issues that we touched on today. So thanks for giving me the opportunity to speak to them and invite them to be part of the conversation with me. I encourage people to go to our Facebook page, Congressman Ted Deutch, and people can follow me on Twitter at Rep Ted Deutch. And a lot of your viewers live in Florida, and a lot of your viewers don't, but one day will. And I'll look forward to meeting them when they move down here.
A real honor having you on the show again,
sir.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.
I'll be right back.
Professor Alon Wolf's research in his biorobotics and biomechanics lab models the genius of nature This snake robot can bring us to life-saving locations, such as the narrow arteries of the body or the perilous depths of disaster sites.
Here at the Bioroponics and Biomechanics Lab, we created a robotic environment where you can play a game for your rehabilitation. We record how you're moving and we adapt the game to your individual needs so that the game changes as you improve. I think the Technion is a really great place to do research because there's a focus on making research that's useful, that'll actually provide benefit to the world.
Rework enables a person that is completely paralyzed, waist down, and completely confined to wheelchair, to walk. It shifts a person from a wheelchair user status to a crutch user status. One more thing about developing the device, everything actually was based on the basic education that they got from the Technion, which is priceless.
Founded by Technion graduates, Insight Tech delivers the operating room of the future, non-invasive surgery and treatment with focused ultrasound.
The technology allows us to treat almost any tumor inside the body. We are treating central nervous system diseases like Parkinson, like essential tremor. We'll definitely look as a next step on brain tumors.
Technion professors Musa Yudim and John Finberg partnered together with Teva Pharmaceuticals to create Azilect, an advanced medicine to slow the progression of Parkinson's disease, providing relief to millions of patients around the world. In award-winning Technion professor Moshe Shoham's laboratory, researchers discovered a way to combine advanced image processing with pioneering miniature robots. Renaissance, the integrated system, is now used in surgery worldwide. Since Technion scientist Professor Joseph Itzkovitz-Eldor co-authored the 1998 paper unveiling the infinite possibilities of stem cell technology, Technion scientists have become leaders in stem cell research.
With the sheer speed of stem cell science and technology, I do think that in the future, we will be able to use stem cells for the treatment of many diseases, from cancer and Parkinson's disease to heart failure.
Engineers Without Borders at the Technion is a volunteer engineering group. We've worked in the Negev Desert here in Israel, in Bedouin communities. We've done some wonderful work in Nepal, where we've developed a biogas reactor. The idea is that our students, together with faculty, develop appropriate engineering and sustainable engineering solutions to problems that we have assessed in developing communities.
Professors do believe that there is a petroleum offshore of Israel. We established the only program in Israel that prepare the engineer to work. Literally, how to work on a rig. Israel can be independent energetically, which is a national task.
For over 100 years, Technion, Israel Institute of Technology, is the place whose people, innovative research, ideas, and inventions make immeasurable contributions to mankind, enhancing the world now and securing your future.
This concludes our special program for today from On Location in Boca Raton, Florida. I'm Richard Peritz. Thank you for being with us.